My name's Noah Wempel, and this is Anna Wempel, and you are here on Cougar Mountain Farm. It's a 320-acre, three-generation family farm. My mother and father bought it in 1972, and we lived up here for a number of years with no water development on this land, and we started looking into developing a pond when we realized that in order to be farmers and have an orchard, we now have about 1,000 apple trees and a little bit of livestock, that to get through the 90-day typical Oregon summer drought, we were going to have to build a large body of water that could deliver us about 5,000 gallons a day is what we anticipated.
Some other reasons why we wanted to build the pond was for fire protection. That's a big one, to have a large reservoir of water in the 90-day dry period, and we're surrounded by all this forest land. Now we have access for a fire truck to come and pump out of, or possibly to dip out of from a helicopter as well, to protect all these acres of forest land around us. So we see here our pond is now naturalized and has the cattail and the alder, and that's brought in amazing wildlife. We now have the blue heron comes and visits us, the wild ducks, the red-winged blackbird. All of those didn't come up this far up into the drylands, but now that we have this water source here for them all summer long, they've moved right in, and so we get to enjoy that benefit as well. In the summertime, it gets so dry. All of this lush green that you see here turns brown, and the sticks in the forest are just tinder, and the fire danger is real in this region, as it is in California and Washington and Idaho. We all know it. And really the only way to protect ourselves is to store a large amount of water that can be accessed at any point when needed in an emergency. We get to take care of two problems in one, in that we get to control erosion in the wintertime when there's such an inflow of water that it's sometimes devastating. And being able to store that water slows that water down, so it lessens the erosion impact. And then on top of it, then we get to use that storage to protect against fire in the summertime. So,
well, I use just a bulldozer for this one. You can employ a large excavator to go with a bulldozer and get more depth. A bulldozer is limited to the amount of depth that can push soil back up and out. And since that time, I've constructed 7 or 8 reservoirs and gotten a little bit better each time. And some have been excavator only, some have been excavator dozer, and some have been dozer only. But if you hit good clay soil, you don't need any liners, you don't need any additives. You just pack it in and watch it fill up. It's a beautiful thing. I mean, I like the story that it was so educational to meet with the water master. Some of our neighbors suggested, why don't you just build a pond? Who needs a permit? And the reality is that someone like me or anybody that's not a professional pond builder shouldn't be building ponds just on a whim. Oregon farmers, ranchers, they need water. And that's our reality, and that's the reality of anybody in this region. The forest land owners need water for fire suppression. Wildlife appreciates it. The erosion control that it helps with, all beneficial things. And so it's in everybody's best interest to build reservoirs and to follow the permit process, because the common sense says you can't build a new storage reservoir in an existing stream, because that's prone to flooding, it's prone to dislocating migrating fish species, and the Pacific salamander. There's a lot of sensitive habitat in the streams that can be disrupted. And I would encourage anybody out there that would like to do the same thing to follow these real basic steps. Number one, meet your local water master, and then that water master is going to tell you, go to your local county and find out if your land qualifies for building a pond. And if so, then he'll bring you back in and send you to the wildlife biologist. And the wildlife biologist will then say, is this proposed storage reservoir in an existing channel, stream channel? If so, you can't build it. Is it going to impact any fish habitat downstream? If so, you can't build it. And so if you can get through those hurdles, the third question they'll ask you is this proposed pond going to impact a wetland? If so, you can't build it. So if you can get around those three hurdles, then you can be sent to the state, and the state will put your proposed reservoir through a public hearings process, which is typically 60 days. And then if there aren't any issues and the state approves and you have your signature from your water master, your local county authority for land use planning, your fish and wildlife, and the state of Oregon, then you can proceed with building your reservoir. And that first permit is to store water. And anyway, this is our successfully permitted ash pond. And it took us about 10 days to build it with a large D7 bulldozer. It really was a pretty quick process once we got on a working relationship with the water master. And that's the beginning point, is to understand what's going to be allowed and what's not going to be allowed. And for building a storage reservoir, that's your first step. Then once we had the water master working with us, he helped us make a site plan map. He directed us to the various agencies to get the other signatures for the permit. I want to say it takes about 4-5 months, maybe 6 months. You should plan on at least 6 months, and that's if everything goes smoothly. We've got a ferro cement tank we can show you for potable water storage and solar powered wells and spring development. Those are things you can do without permits.
So this is another strategy for storing water. This is a ferro cement tank. It's 10,000 gallons. We're using this to store potable water from our solar powered well up the hill, which then gravity flows water here and fills this up. And this creates a buffer between dry times. And in the winter time, there was just an overflow of water pouring down, as you can see around us now in the springtime. All of the ditches are flowing with water. All of the little gullies are full, and the water's just streaming off the ground. And we saw that the way to mitigate those two extremes was to create water storage. Once we started implementing this plan of storing the water when it's abundant for when it's scarce, the entire feeling of the mountain changed. We started really feeling like you could have human development here and agriculture development here and a way to create a sustainable lifestyle here. It was this water development plan and implementation that we've gone through over the past 15 years.